So welcome everyone. I want to remind everyone here to please sign into the link provided in the chat by Joanna. If you have any issues with signing in, please make sure to direct message her. If you have any questions during the course of the presentation, especially for our panelists today, please make sure to direct them to Jessica and we will address them at the conclusion of the presentation. Also, a short survey will be shared in the chat by Joanna towards the end of the event. So please make sure to take a couple of minutes to complete this survey for us. We have ASL interpretation services by Jo Beth and closed captioning provided by Tara. You can enable closed captioning by selecting live transcript and enabling captions. Thank you for being here. Before I introduce today's presenters, I want to offer a land acknowledgement on behalf of the Planning Committee. Every community owes its existence and vitality to generations from around the world who contributed their hopes, dreams, and energy to making the history that led to this moment. Some were brought here against their will, some were drawn to leave their distant homes in hope of a better life, and some have lived on this land for more generations than can be counted. Truth and acknowledgement are critical to building mutual respect and connection across all barriers of heritage and difference. We begin this effort to acknowledge what has been buried by honoring the truth. We are currently occupying ancestral land of the Tongva people. In our work to promote social justice and education, we must always consider the many legacies of violence, displacement, migration, and settlement that bring us together here today. With that being said, I'd like to welcome you all to this evening's presentation for Latinx Heritage Month. This is Glendale Community College's second year observing Latinx Heritage Month, and our theme for this year is celebrating our diverse stories, voices, and identities. The Planning Committee selected this team to celebrate the unique individuals within the Latinx community, despite the various challenges they face in this country. Lastly, it is an honor to introduce our two panelists for today's Afro-Latinx Beauty and Representation event, Alexa Dolmo and Ada Rojas. One second as we add our spotlights here. Give me one second. I'm also going to spotlight our ASL interpreter. There we go, perfect. So just a quick bio on both of our amazing speakers. I'll introduce Alexa first. So Alexa Dolmo, known as Alexa Darling, is a 25-year-old Garifuna, ooh, messed that up, I apologize. Garifuna woman born in La Ceiba, Honduras, currently residing in Houston, Texas. Alexa moved from Honduras to the States when she was 14 years old. She is currently a lifestyle blogger, content creator, podcast host and owner of Darling SKN, an organic bath and body brand. Alexa has built a social media platform by making YouTube videos and connecting with people via Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, etc. She has a passion for inspiring others through art and encouragement, whether that be through photographs or beauty related content. So that is Alexa, welcome. Our next panelist is Ada Rojas, who is a serial entrepreneur who specializes in establishing successful ventures with a lifestyle focus that infuses themes of culture, community, and confidence. A consumer creative with a multifaceted career, she is an accomplished speaker, marketing consultant, and the CEO and founder of Vecina Couture. Oh my God, a lot of words. Vecina Couture, a luxury line of loungewear. Had to say it twice just to get it right, Ada. Vecina Couture. As a veteran in the digital media industry, she is sought after by some of the nation's biggest brands as a thought partner and frequent collaborator. With that being said, it is my pleasure to welcome both Alexa and Ada to our event tonight. Thank you both so much for being here.
Thank you for having us.
As we get started with our event, just our first question is, can you both tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and how you identify? And you can go in whichever order you would like.
You want to go first?
So my name is Ada Rojas. I identify as an Afro-Latina, Black Latina. I guess, should I share a little bit more about kind of like my own experience with that? So I'm Dominican American. I was made in Dominican Republic, but I was born here. And I'm one of six. So I come from a single family home of six children. I'm the middle child. I'm a first generation graduate. Like, I'm the one in my family who's accomplished so many firsts. I'm the first like entrepreneur. And so, you know, growing up, I didn't know life outside of being Dominican. Growing up in the Bronx, I grew up in this bubble of other Caribbean folks and people that look like me. So it was never like, am I Black? Am I white? It was just like, I'm Dominican. That's what I am. So as I started to get older and be in spaces that were outside of my little bubble, people would often ask me like, oh, are you mixed? Are you Black? And I'm like, no, I'm just Dominican. I don't understand like what you're asking me. I'm Dominican. And so it wasn't actually until I took a Caribbean's an African study class in college that I really, really got to know more about my history and where I come from and the fact that I am Black. And it was like, I remember having this almost like aha moment in class, like, oh my God, I'm Black. And it's something that in our community, especially in my household, is not talked about, even though my family is visibly Black, but it's something that we would just kind of throw under the rug, right? And so that kind of journey really led me to start embracing who I am, to really start claiming more ownership, because obviously, like, as someone with curly hair and just the way that I look, like, yes, I am Black. I'm visibly Black. I'm visibly mixed. And just kind of like owning that journey, sharing my experience online and helping other women who were kind of like figuring out their roots and really tapping into who they are. So that was kind of like where my journey started. And I'm just very proud of who I am, where I come from, like the blood that runs through my veins that is so resilient. And like, I'm so proud to be a Black Latina.
All right, I'll go next. I can actually relate to Ada. I actually do, I always call myself, yo digo que soy garifuna, first and foremost, because I was actually, you know, born in Honduras. And so it's kind of tricky for me. And I always like had issues doing this, explain myself, because I'm like, okay, I'm garifuna, but I'm also like Honduras. And, you know, I have the Latin, you know, the Latin, you know, todo Latino. So to me, I'm going to say that I am, you know, it's a song, but yes, I am garifuna actually. So my family, all of my, you know, my whole life growing up back home, I grew up in a garifuna, you know, in a garifuna culture, of course, but also I was around a lot of Latinos. And so that's why I also do consider myself Afro-Latina, because I'm in that space. I grew up in that space, and I actually was born in Honduras. So, you know, I moved here when I was 14 years old. I am the youngest of, my mom only got, it's only two of us, but pretty much I'm the youngest of all. And I am the first one who, you know, like Ada, who came to the stage, you know, into the whole entrepreneurial lifestyle, blogging and the whole digital creator thing is not really a thing in my family. So I'm like the first one of, you know, all of them doing this stuff and being in the space and in the media and all that. But yeah, I pretty much grew up, you know, listening to bachata, listening to merengue, listening to punta, which is garifuna. You guys will learn more about that. And then, you know, I'm very diverse. I don't like to put myself in one box, because I'm very diverse. I can actually, you know, party with Caribbeans. I can party with Latinos. I can party with my people. You know what I'm saying? I can do it all. So I don't like to put myself in one box. But like Ada said, I'm very proud of myself of being a Black woman who speaks Spanish and, you know, representing my culture everywhere I go.
So beautiful. Thank you both for sharing. I love that sazon, you know? I know you both kind of touch a little bit, and I touch a little bit on your intro about the work that you do. So can you all explain a little bit about what you do and how did you even get started in the work that you do, you know, on a daily basis? And what does that kind of look like for you?
I'll go ahead first. So for me, it was so funny because actually I started doing like YouTube videos maybe like 6 years ago. I was actually in a very little dark space in my life at the moment, and makeup was my getaway. Like that was, you know, the only thing that I loved to do at the time. And so during that time, the, you know, how to do your eyebrows thing was trending. So I was like, okay, everybody will ask me, how do you do your eyebrows? And I was just like, okay, let me just do a video on YouTube. Y'all, I had no idea how to use YouTube. I didn't have nothing. I think I had the iPhone 6 back then. And I recorded myself, did my video, and that's how everything pretty much started, you know. And going to school, I used to always get bullied in school because I was like the only Black girl who spoke Spanish then. They thought, they would call me Mexican all the time. They were like, you're not Black, you're Mexican. You know, they were confusing nationality with race all the time. And so I'm like, okay, we have a problem here. Mind you, I couldn't speak English when I first got here. So it was a challenge for me and I couldn't really defend myself. I couldn't really educate people whenever they were like, you know, make fun of me and all that. So I think 2 years later down the line, that's when I started my YouTube channel and I started doing videos trying to educate people on being Afro-Latina. And that video did pretty good. I was like, wow, like all these people watching my videos. Okay, I'm doing something right. And so from then, I just started doing my, you know, makeup tutorials, but I started seeing a pattern like, okay, this is not really doing me. That's not what's popping, right? Clearly they like something else. They like the fact that I'm different, you know, my accent and all these things. And so I started to embrace it more. And I eventually even stopped doing the whole makeup stuff. And I just transitioned to being a lifestyle blogger. And I created my blog, my own blog at home myself, and started writing different articles and stuff. I think my first article there was the difference between nationality, race, and ethnicity. That I also did pretty good. Because, you know, my thing is, I want to educate people about who we really are because people are so confused. And it's like, come on, y'all, it's 2021. It shouldn't be taboo. You know what I'm saying? But that's pretty much how everything started for me and, you know, being a lifestyle blogger. And it's crazy, y'all, because when I moved here, didn't know how to speak English. I was afraid of even being in front of cameras. Now I'm like, I own a whole business. I'm doing this, like God is good. And I'm just proud of, you know, of my progress and my growth.
And for me, so I'm a little bit older than Alexa. I'm 31. I can't believe I'm in my 30s. Sometimes I'd be like, you know, it's so crazy because the term Afro-Latina didn't even exist like when we were growing up. So it's like, again, that even added more to like people when people would ask me like, are you Black? Are you? I'm like, I'm Dominican. I don't, you know, so it's like that whole race and the you know, race and ethnicity thing. And so I actually went to school for public relations and advertising. And there was at the time on YouTube in 2010, there was this big boom of African-American women going natural. And I had been natural my whole life because I grew up in a single family home of six. Unlike my other Dominican friends, my mom couldn't afford to send me to the hair salon every week to blow out my hair. That was like a luxury in my household because my mom couldn't afford it. So I had no choice but to embrace my curly hair, even though I didn't really like it growing up because we were taught that the, you know, ideal beauty standards is this straight hair. I had no choice but to wear my hair curly to school because I didn't have that as an option. So I remember when I was younger, I'm like, okay, well, if I put conditioner in it and if I braid it, when I take out the braids in the morning, then my hair won't look like I won't have an afro. So I was doing like a braid out before braid out were even a thing. So in 2010, you know, a lot of African-American women on YouTube had natural hair channels. And I'm like, well, how come nobody's talking to the Latina girls who have curly hair? And I was like, well, if no one's doing it, then I'll do it, because people would always ask me on the street, like, what do you put in your hair? How do you take care of your curly hair? And because I had grown up with curly hair, I kind of already knew it. And the crazy thing is that in college, one of my roommates had a flat iron. So I was like, oh my God, I can straighten my hair myself. Like finally I'll have straight hair. And I actually damaged all of my curls straightening it in college. And so I remember somebody told me once, like, oh my God, I love when you straighten your hair because you don't look so Spanish. And I'm like, what does that even mean? Like, you know? And so I was, thanks to the YouTube videos that I watched from the African-American woman, I was able to learn how to like go back, transition my hair back to curly. So everybody was like, how did you do it? And I'm like, YouTube. So they're like, can you teach me? So I, everything that I learned, thanks to the woman on YouTube, I created my own channel. And that's how everything kind of started. And because I've studied public relations and advertising in college, that really helped me, set me apart from the other bloggers, because I knew how to write a headline. I knew how to write a PR pitch. And like, I just started networking. I was living in New York, so I was going to every single event, and things just kind of took off. Like, brands started reaching out to me before even a content, being a content creator was a thing. I was like, you guys want to pay me to talk about your hair products? Like, I just do this for fun. And it wasn't until one of my professors was like, hey, like, you're doing something like really big. Like, this is where the world is headed. And I don't think you realize that what you're doing, it can be a career. So I did a few internships and beauty PR firms, and I was like, this is cool, but I'm already starting with my own brand. I'd rather do this for myself. And to make a long story short, 12 years later, here I am. I've created multiple businesses. I had a hair care brand that I actually co-founded, and I exited the brand last year. That's in mass retail, Walmart and Target. I, you know, have my luxury homeware line, and I have my influencer business. So it's really crazy to think that I make a living by being myself and using my creativity, and I get paid for it. Like, I feel so, like Alexa said, I feel so blessed and so honored that like, this is really my life.
Yeah. Wow, you're both so inspiring. I love how you touch on how your own identity played a role, right? In terms of, you both touch on kind of what inspired you, but I'm curious, in terms of the jobs and the things that you're both involved in right now, how do you feel like they ultimately relate to the goals and the things you want to achieve in the future? And how does that play a role with your own identity and where you see your identity folding into that process?
I think for me, I always wanted to really like put out my culture out there. I don't think enough people know about Garifuna people. And so that's pretty much what my platform is about, right? Like, okay, really showing who I am, you know, showing the food, you know, the dances that we do. And, you know, that, so I even opened up a whole different platform that is called Garifuna Bosses, right? So this platform, pretty much the goal was for me to connect and help out other Garifuna businesses at no cost, just basically sharing their businesses on that platform. I don't know, well, I'm pretty sure Ada has seen this, but there's a lot of like, blogger communities pages, you know, that they create on social media, on Instagram. So I'm like, I've never seen one for Garifuna people. Let me do one for my people, right? And that's pretty much how that came about. And all what I do is help other Garifuna people and, you know, showing out the, you know, the culture through that platform. And it feels really great when other people come to me and they, you know, reach out to me because they want to learn more about the culture. They ask me questions. I've had a lot of college students, you guys, who I reached out to through that platform just because they're doing a project, research project, and they ask me questions about the culture. And so that's pretty much what's my goal, to kind of educate people on both things, being Afro-Latina and Garifuna, of course, because it's like I said, I feel like I'm in the middle, but I love it because like I said, I'm not really put in one box and I'm really able to, you know, just be myself and be creative and, you know, show it all out. But that's pretty much my goal, and that's kind of like how, you know, like the question you asked, how my work kind of blends in with what I do. So
and for me, same, like, you know, I'm all about everything that I do at the heart of all that I do with through all of my businesses, through my work online, is really centered in community, culture, and confidence. And for me, it's really important to, like, I know what it's like to feel ni de aquí, ni de allá, like, because I'm Dominican American, when I go to Dominican Republic, like, I don't feel, people are like, you're not Dominican enough because you weren't born here, right? Even though my first language is Spanish and, you know, I have that immigrant experience. But then here, you know, the African-American community is like, you're not Black enough because you speak Spanish. So it's like that feeling of feeling like you don't belong. Like, I grew up with that all my life. Even, you know, I'm a nerd, like I'm such a nerdy girl, but because I don't look like a nerd, you know, people underestimate me, you know, even though like I graduated with honors, I was in AP classes, but also, you know, I was in AP honors English, all of that stuff. But then I was like in remedial math. So then I was cool with all of the other kids that weren't, you know. So I've always had this plethora of circles. I've always been a very layered person. And I've always been, the main thing is that I've always been underestimated because of where I come from and what I look like. And I know what it's like to feel like you never fit in anywhere. So for me, it's so important to create spaces for our community, spaces where we can show up as our full multi-dimensional selves without feeling like I need to dumb myself down, because I could be talking to you like this, but then I could flip, you know, I could code switch and I'll do a killer presentation. I'm a businesswoman. And it's like, I just don't feel like we have enough spaces for us to show up as our multi-dimensional selves. So with my work, with my businesses, I'm always putting on for my culture and bringing others with me. So like this past weekend, we did a huge collaboration, my business with HBO Max, and Alexa was one of the influencers that we hired for the campaign. So it's like, to me, it's not about me. It's like, okay, I made it this far. I've been doing this for 12 years. How can I get bigger? Like, okay, I'm going to go to these corporate companies. I'm going to take their money and I'm going to give opportunity to me and my people. You know, I'm going to give more visibility, because at the end of the day, I have something that they want, right? I am the culture, and I have that community that they're looking to tap into. So if you want to talk to that community, you're going to have to go through me. Like, you don't know how to talk to them in the way that I know how to talk to them, because I've been building them, that community, for 12 years. And if you want access to them, well, you're going to have to go through me, and you're going to also have to pay us, because we deserve to get paid. So like, I'm all about that. Like, I do not play when it comes to my people.
I love it. By the way, guys, if you're watching this, make sure y'all go check out Bettina Couture. They have the bomb.
Yes, I'm wearing a robe from my, this is from my line. This is a robe from my brand.
Love it. I'm going to talk about it because it's so good. It's so good.
And we'll definitely be putting those links up as well, because definitely everyone wants to see them, I'm sure. But thank you so much for elaborating on how, you know, you're inspired by your own community to give back. And you both kind of touch a little bit about what your experience has been like as an Afro-Latina, you know, Ada, you talked about how ni de aquí ni de allá, right? Where it's a very common conception in the Latinx community that we don't feel like we're from there or from here. We're in this in-between status. So I'm curious, for both of you, what has been your perception of Latinidad in the US from, you know, when you were growing up to maybe what it is now, if you feel like it's different? And how do you feel like that experience has been impacted as yourself, as an Afro-Latina woman growing up in the United States? And you both kind of touched upon it, but I'm curious if you have a little bit more to say about what Latinidad looks like in the US and your own experience in it.
For me, honestly, it was kind of weird because when I first moved here, because, okay, I would see other, you know, Hispanics and I would like speak Spanish and they'll be like, oh my God, you speak Spanish? You know, and I would be like, wait, come on now. Y'all see us like back home. Y'all see us back home. You know what I'm saying? Like, it shouldn't be like, oh my God, I've never seen a Black woman. So that's kind of how it was for me growing up. And I was getting it from, you know, African-Americans, because clearly they were not educated on it. You know what I'm saying? So growing up for me was very, I wanted to fit in so much in the African-American culture. And I always told myself, I want to speak, yo quiero tener ese acento americano. I want to have the American accent, you know? And I always was so hard on myself about it, because I was so like, I was ashamed sometimes, I'm not gonna lie, to sit there and explain where I was from and why I was Black and why I spoke Spanish. That was back then, we're talking about 10 years ago. Now, I've seen a lot of like change. Like, I actually see, you know, thanks to social media, right? We have made so much difference with, you know, sharing our, you know, our stories online and people seeing who we are and learning about who we are and things like that. So I do feel like we have made a difference, influencers, honestly, because I think it's starting to become more normal. Like, you know, okay, yeah, Afro-Latina. Okay, yeah, she's Afro-Latina. You know what I'm saying? It's different. So I do think that by using social media the right way, a lot of us have educated a lot of people who were not even educated, because I don't even think people do that on purpose. It's just they don't know. And, you know, a lot of those things, they're not taught in school. So, yeah, I think that's how it was for me, at least when I was growing up. But we're making progress, so.
Yeah, for sure. I feel like for as long as I could remember, when people talk about Latinos, they just put us in a lump sum and they think that we're a monolith. And I think that's why I had even like my own identity issues, because I'm like, you know, I would go into, so my mom moved us from the Bronx to Florida. So I lived in Florida for 10 years. And most of the schools that I went to were predominantly white. And the Latinos that were there were either like, you know, they weren't Dominican, they weren't Caribbean. So it was like, oh, but you're Latina. And I'm like, yes, but like, I eat like arroz, habichuela, and carne at home. Like, I don't eat tortilla. So it's like, and then trying to explain that to people back then, when again, like they just had such a limited mindset about what Latinos look like. And I think just again, trying to fit in, it's like, oh, I don't feel like I fit in anywhere. And even now, you know, I moved back to the Bronx because I just felt like in Florida, I was never going to get anywhere. I moved back to the Bronx and my mom's like, you're so crazy. I worked so hard to move us out of the Bronx and you're going back. And I'm like, I just know that there's more for me here. I can do more. And I'm so grateful that I did. And I followed my heart because I was able to accomplish so much in New York. But 2 years ago, I moved to Chicago because my hair care business, the products were made there. And, you know, in Chicago, most of the Latinos there are Mexican or Puerto Rican. There's like no Dominicans there. So again, I went from being in my bubble to being like, oh my God, there's no Dominicans, right? So if, si yo quiero arroz habichuela y carne, I have to cook it at home myself, or like, or I'll go to the Puerto Rican restaurant, like 45 minutes north. And so where I live now, it's a predominantly Black community. So I'm even getting more in touch with like, just the African-American culture, because it's also African-American culture in the Midwest, right? So people, when I open, they see me, they're like, okay, she's Black. And then I open my mouth and they're like, wait, like you look Black, but there's like a little accent, there's a little something. So yeah, educating them on like, yes, I'm a Black Latina, I'm Dominican. And even like from the music, right? They're like, oh, how do you not know this Prince song? I'm like, my mom did not grow up listening to Prince. My mom grew up listening to Frank Reyes. I can tell you who the Dominican Prince is. I can tell you who the Dominican Michael Jackson is. I can tell you who the Dominican, you know, like, but I did not grow up listening to this Black American music because I am a Black Latina. So it's just all these nuances. And I'm so grateful for social media and for the ability to talk to people all over the world, because I don't know how much longer my spirit could handle, like, again, being put in a monolith, right? Like, when I was with the Latinos, I was too urban for them. When I'm with the Black folks, I'm too Latino. And it's like, oh, I'm just tired of feeling like this, you know? But we're making progress, like Alexa said.
We are. We really are.
Look at this conversation. Like, are you kidding? I would have loved to have seen this when I was in college, because the word wasn't even around.
I agree. I never had, when I was in school, we never had any of this, you know, like any of this stuff. So this is really good because people are getting more knowledgeable, like I said, you know. So imagine 10 years from now, we might be in a whole different space. You might see a negrita como yo, you know, on a novela or something. Who knows?
Yes.
I would definitely watch that novela, Alexa. Let me know how we do that. No, but I agree. I think, you know, you both speak about something that's a really big issue within the Latinx community, you know, from the outside perspective, being seen as a monolith, right? It's like, it's only Mexicans, it's only, or even just white Latinx folks, right? People that look like me, very white passing, very white. We don't often think about the diversity within the Latinx community. And for you all to also have to encounter the additional challenge of being part of the Black community, but also sometimes not being seen as a Black community, right? So I think you talk about a lot of challenges that you face, and I'm curious, what are some of the maybe other successes or challenges that you have faced as you're going through your own careers, especially as Afro-Latinas, and especially in the realm or the industry that you're in where you are so visible all the time?
Go ahead.
Well, for me, I'm not gonna lie. I will say, like, on the other side of the token, like, it's great that we have all the visibility, but on the other side of the token, what I get frustrated with is when I see a lot of people trying to, like, who are not in touch with their identity, who don't identify as Black, but because being an Afro-Latina is trendy right now, they're like, oh, Afro-Latinas, being an Afro-Latina is lit. Oh, I'm Afro-Latina now. And it's really frustrating because, again, it's like, I'm not here to judge everyone's experience. You can identify however you want to identify, because if you go on my YouTube channel, I have videos of me talking about being Afro-Latina, and the comments of the videos are crazy, of people fighting back and forth on who can claim it, who can't claim it, that Latinos are not Black. I mean, it is crazy. But I that part I don't like, of people like trying to monetize off of the trendiness. And I'm like, this is not a trend for us. This is not a trend. Like, we walk into rooms and it's like, they're not gonna, I can't walk into a boardroom and they're gonna look at me and be like, oh, that girl's Dominican. No, they're gonna be like, she's Black. Like, I, you know, so it's like, this is not something that I can just take on and put on. Like, I live with this, you know. Alexa's darker, than she's even more visibly Black. So this is not a trend. This is not a game. This is not a mask that you put on to take advantage of the fact that people are checking for us, right? Because especially right now, like during Latinx Heritage Month, it's like, I'm so grateful that we're being highlighted, right? So there's a lot more attention on us. When Black History Month comes around, we get highlighted too, because they're like, oh, they're Black as well. Yeah. So to me, I think that's been the most frustrating part, is seeing people who not really about it and are not down for the culture, trying to token, like just commercialize and take advantage of what's happening here. That's really frustrating, because for me, this is not a game. And it's like, I've been about it and I've been about my community, and it's kind of frustrating to see.
I think for me, I would say a lot of the times the same community, you know, we sometimes can be very, you know, we don't support each other as much, you know what I'm saying? Like Ala said, you have a lot of Latinos who can be sometimes very rude, you know what I'm saying? And it's just like, well, why? We're all Latinos, we all come, you know, we have a lot in common, pretty much. We kind of eat the same food. We just have different names for it. Like, I call frijoles to beans. You guys call it erasure, right? So, you know what I'm saying? It's the same stuff, it's just different names. But I do agree with, like, with what Ada said, because that's really what it is. And I feel like we really supposed to come up closer, instead of really, like, you know, bashing ourselves, if that makes sense. It shouldn't be that way. But at the same time, that's always gonna be like that. I don't think that's gonna change. You know,
the changes. I feel like we're doing our part to be part of that change. I know, like, last year during Black Lives Matter, like, I was like, okay, what can I do with my platform during this time? And I actually gathered a bunch of people that I knew in the industry. And for a week on my Instagram platform, I hosted a series called Afro-Latinx and Identity. And I spoke about Afro-Latinx identity in the media, in motherhood, in relationships. And I interviewed all these different people that were Latino and Black, and to really have that beautiful conversation. And I can't even begin to tell you the amount of messages that I got from other Latinas who either felt similar, or, you know, people just seeing, like, yes, like, all Black Lives Matter includes Afro-Latino people as well, because we're Black. So it's like, those conversations are so important. And I really hope, Alexa, that 10 years from now, you know, we can say that, like, people just have more understanding and are more compassionate and have done the work themselves to be able to understand, you know.
I feel like if we keep doing what we're doing now, we will get there. You know what I'm saying? We're already doing progress, y'all. Because when I'm, like I said, 10 years ago, it was so different. But now, thanks to the media, right, we're doing a lot. We're doing good. So let's keep it up, y'all.
And honestly, we have people like you to thank, right? I mean, the internet has been such an important tool to have these conversations, but these conversations wouldn't be happening without people who are like you two, who are very open and very vulnerable and raw about your own experiences as Afro-Latinas in the United States. So you all should be patting yourselves on the back too for the incredible work that you're doing. And since you both are in the realm of kind of the beauty industry, I'm kind of curious to see, you both kind of talked a little bit about your upbringing as Afro-Latinas. How has your perception of beauty kind of maybe changed over time? Maybe from when you were younger to where you are now, and maybe what your roles in the industry that you play now have impacted them, if anything?
That's a good question. So for me, when I was 13 years old, I think for me always, it's this whole, it has always been hair, right? So when I was like 13 years old, I was still back in Honduras. My mom relaxed my hair, right? But one thing about me, my mom used to make fun of me because she's like, I always wanted long hair. And so I used to like do my twist out when I was younger, But when I started getting older, I wanted to be cute, right? So I wanted to feel like, you know, a pelo así, a pelo suave, you know, because I have my hair is really thick and, you know, it's a fro. So, all right, that pretty much changed when I moved here, when I moved to the States, because bottom line, it was still the same because I was wearing a lot of wigs, you know, spending $100 in the wig because I wanted to be cute and I wanted to have long hair. And it was crazy because I think a lot of this happened because what I saw on TV, right? There was not enough representation of women like myself on TV. So I wanted to look like people on TV. But anyways, I ended up, like, I feel like a few years ago, I started like loving my hair more and I went through this like self-love journey and I, you know, really getting to know myself. And I actually ended up liking my hair because I was like, I'm tired of spending money on this. Like I'm spending $500 sometimes on a wig. Like, y'all, that's crazy. So I started like, you know, pretty much embracing my natural hair more. And even they even took a toll on me because even with dating, you know, I was like, okay, I might not get a lot of guys. Guys might not even like me because of my hair. You know what I'm saying? And it was, I started to feel very insecure about it. But I began to like, really like, you know, just love on me and love on my hair. And I ended up locking my hair. These of course are extensions, but I do have locks. I'm a locked queen. And so, yeah, like, I feel like as soon as I did that, you know, I started feeling so much better about myself. I learned so much about my own hair that I did not know about my hair. I didn't know my hair could curl, like the way it curls, you know? And so I think that had a lot to do with lack of representation, you know, of Black women on TV, because we, you know, we get, I feel like TV is a huge influence on everyone. And so I was influenced by that, you know? But also I think, you know, thanks to social media, right? And other people also who were embracing their own hair, that also inspired me to do the same with mine. So that's how kind of like that took effect on me. Oh, yeah. Did I answer that question? I feel like I'll be all over the place. I'm sorry.
For me, I always wonder how different my self-esteem, how much earlier I would have developed a healthy self-esteem if I would have been growing up during these times, because not only for me was it the hair, but it was also my body. Like I'm 5'10". I am very curvy. I'm plus size. So it's like, I literally take up space when I walk into rooms. Like you just can't miss me. You see the hair and then you see my body. And that for me, like I grew up being very insecure at 13. I had the same body that I had now. And I remember wearing like a bra and a sports bra to go to school to like minimize my chest and like long shirts to cover up my butt. So I was very self-conscious about the way that I looked and also my hair. And, you know, my natural hair journey was really what allowed me to learn to rely on like things that are not physical, because when my hair was damaged, it's like, okay, well, you don't have anything. So it's like, what about me makes me beautiful that it's not physical, right? My heart, my soul, my passion, my creativity. I really had to learn, lean into things that are not physical about me that make me a beautiful person. And that was a really rough journey, because for a long time, when I looked in the mirror, I did not feel beautiful, especially with my hair at all and the way that I looked. And, you know, again, like for me, the reason why I'm so passionate about sharing my journey and sharing my thoughts and experiences, because I think about Ada 10 years ago, and if she were to find my Instagram, and she would be like, oh my God, I feel so seen. Like, even as, you know, that never gets old to me. I still have moments where like I feel so seen, and I know the impact that it has on people when they feel seen. So if I have to be the first one to put myself out there so that other people can feel seen, I'm okay with doing that, because I don't want other people to experience what I experienced growing up. And I want people to love themselves for who they are and to love their journey and to love being this multifaceted person. But yeah, like media for sure has played a lot into like our own ideals about who we are. But also I think that's a big part of our job, is dismantling that and really hoping that people come home to themselves sooner, a lot sooner than we did.
Yep.
Well said, well said. Thank you both for sharing. I had someone send me directly a question, if y'all are okay with opening it up to questions. So someone asked me to ask you all, if you're willing to share, what has been some of your experiences with anti-Blackness and internalized racism? And how do you use your platforms to maybe discuss or combat these issues within our community?
Yeah, I mean, our own families. Like, my great-grandmother was Black, and she was very racist. And I remember as a child going to visit, because all of my family is in Dominican Republic. I don't have any cousins or aunts, or all of my immediate family is there. So, like, when we would go in the summers to visit, like, that to me was like, oh my God, I feel so at home. And so my great grandmother would make these remarks. And as a child, I remember being so dumbfounded, because I'd be like, pero mama, tú eres negra, like, you're Black and you're talking bad about Black people, but you're like, I just didn't understand. I'm like, what is it that, does she not know that she's Black? And it's like, then now getting older and understanding, right? It's not like that came from somewhere, right? Like, her hating herself and the way that she looked came from somewhere. My great grandmother grew up in the Trujillo era. For those of you not familiar with Dominican history, Trujillo was like the Dominican version of Hitler. And he had a mission to wipe out all of the Black people from Dominican Republic. He killed a lot of Haitians that were in the Dominican Republic. So literally, like, my grandmother claiming her Blackness, she could die for claiming her Blackness. So I think about all of our Dominican parents and all our Dominican grandparents who are watching us be so proudly claiming our Blackness, and how what they're thinking looking at us, like, oh my God, we could have died back in the day for claiming our Blackness and owning who we are, and our children are being so unapologetic about that. And I'm sure deep down they're probably proud, but also they're scared because they grew up with not being able to own their Blackness or claim it, or Black was ugly. So it's like having the balls to have those very uncomfortable conversations with your own family member, having the balls to call out your own family members when you hear them saying things like that, because it all starts in the home. It's like, I can only do so much about what happens outside of the home, right? Like, I'm not going to, me, myself, Ada Virginia Rosa, is not going to change racism in the world. But you best believe that if anybody in my immediate surrounding, like, I'm going to check them. And you might have fallouts in your family because of it. You might not talk to family members, but it's like, you have to stand for something. And I know when I have children, like, my children are going to be raised to be very proud of their, all of their heritage, being American, being Dominican, being Black, you know, that's very important for me. And it's hard conversations to have, but like, we have to start in the home. And I know for me, a lot of things growing up that my family members say, like, being the 31-year-old woman that I am now, if I could go back in time, it's like, let me tell you something, right? But I was a child. So yeah, it's having those really hard conversations. And that's part of the work that I do online and offline, right? You can't just do it online. What are you doing when no one is watching too? That's important.
I can agree with Ada. Honestly, I never really had those issues in my family. Like, we pretty much, you know, growing up, like I said, the culture, right? I always knew who I was. I never had any issues like identifying myself who I was. So I can really say that my family was like that in that aspect, but I do feel like outside of the home, a lot of times I did have to defend myself and I had to explain to people, I am Black. Like, what are you talking about? Like, it's so funny because when I was in middle school, somebody told me, you're not Black, you're Mexican. And I'm like, okay, but I know I'm Black. I know you see that I'm Black. So I'm like, you know, it's like I always had to defend myself, and I would get upset a lot of times, you know, having to I kept repeating myself over and over and over again. But then I was like, you know what, when I got older, because that was like when I was like 14, 16, you know. But then when I got older, I understood, I'm like, okay, these people really don't know. Like, you know, it's not really like their fault, you know what I'm saying? You have to really educate them. So that's where I'm like, okay, let me just switch some stuff up with my platform, and let me actually tell people how this works, because, you know, it's not, I get it, not everybody knows, but like I said, we're making progress.
You both bring up really good points about the challenges within the communities, right? And it's not even within your own families, but it's also, you know, thinking about the privilege that a lot of us who are white Latinx folks have, and us having those difficult conversations, right? When we hear people saying comments or saying things that are not appropriate, right? So I think it also is incumbent on our own community, not just YouTube, because you have a platform, right? Because you are going to use your platform to educate, but it's also on everybody in the community, right? So you bring up really good points. So
attacking that privilege, I was going to say, because even for me, right, like I have certain privileges over Alexa because I'm lighter and because I have a looser curl texture, right? So knowing when we're talking about centering Blackness, if I am the lightest person in the room, I need to pass the mic because it's like, it's not about me, right? So understanding your privilege in so many ways. And even like both Alexa and I have so much more privilege compared to our families that live in our home countries, right? Because we live here, like understanding and acknowledging the privilege that you have in so many different areas of your life. And again, working on how do you center Blackness? What can you do to help those that are in less, like in positions that can't defend themselves?
Yes, that's very true.
Yeah, no, thank you for adding that super important piece of the conversation. Having said all of that, I mean, what is one thing you wish people knew about the Latinx community and specifically within, you know, Afro-Latinidad community, right? I mean, that's a very specific portion of our community that doesn't get heard often. So if there's one thing you wish people knew about being Afro-Latina or being part of the Latinx community and not having that same experience as, you know, the dominant narrative in the U.S., what would you wish people knew?
That we don't all look the same. We're very diverse. You know what I'm saying? We come in different shades, different, you know, body types, everything. We're so diverse. Even like the different, like I said earlier, the names of the foods, they can be, we have a different name in different countries, but it's really the same stuff. You know what I'm saying? The flavor, I might go to Honduras and then I might go to Peru, let's say, I don't know, Peru. And then the food might taste a little different, but it's pretty much the same, you know, type of food. So it's like, we're very diverse. And, which is something that I like about being Afro-Latina, because I'm not like, like I said, I can go anywhere and have a good time, literally anywhere. And, you know, the fact that I'm Black and I speak Spanish, it's so funny because I can go somewhere, they might be talking about me and I'm like, ¿Cómo que dijo? Excuse me, you know? So I just love that diversity that we bring, you know, that we bring. And the fact that we can all pretty much meet in the middle, if that makes sense, you know, because we have so many things in common.
Yeah. And for me, I would say, being pro-Black doesn't mean that you're anti-white. It doesn't mean that you're anti-, it just means that you're proud to be Black, just how we are proud to be Latinos, and any chance that we get, we're like, I'm Latin. Like, literally, it doesn't matter what nationality of Latinidad you're from, you are proud, right? So the same way that we are all proud to be Latinos is the same exact way that we are proud to be Black women. And just because I am pro-Black doesn't mean that I'm anti-Latino, that I'm anti-white. It just means I'm really proud to be Black. And then to add that on top of that, I am Black and Latina. Are you kidding?
Like,
I am going to be doing the most at all times, because it's like, wow. Like, I think I'm like, if I could come back into the world as anything, I would not want to be anything other than a Black Latina. Like, I feel like we are living, like, for me personally, I have the best of everything, the best of, I would not want to be nothing else but a Black Latina. Like, I love it here. I truly love it.
You sound very passionate, Al. I love it.
I just love being Black and Latina. Are you kidding? Like, I love it here.
I was about to say, saca la bandera. He's about to bring out the flag. He's about to rep everything. And I love it. No, I think the passion is very, very touching. And I love that you're so proud of it. In terms of like other people who are here, right? We have students, we have staff, faculty. But one of the biggest components of our school is obviously our students. So what is one piece of advice that you would give to students who might want to follow a similar path to yours, which is a very big thing, right? A lot of Gen Z is very much into social media, the digital media world. So what advice would you give to others who maybe want to follow a similar path, especially maybe other Afro-Latinas who feel the same way that you do as you're speaking right now and want to pursue something similar to that?
I would say go for it and don't be afraid and be yourself. I feel like people are really forcing themselves sometimes on social media to be this and to be that, you know what I'm saying? And it's just like, we can see it, like it's noticeable when it's forced. Just be yourself, you know. I feel like we all have, we're all different, we all have a different story, and you have to be authentic with it. If you're forcing it, it's not gonna work for you. But go, you know, just do you, be genuine too. I feel like people try to, like, you know, force everything, even like the post, even the caption, even the picture. Like, no, it don't work like that. I think if you want to be successful in this industry, you also have to be very confident, because the hate comments are going to be there. The, you know, people are going to talk about you all the time. They're going to make fake pages about you all the time. Like, it's not easy, and people often see the picture, but it's a lot of work behind the scenes that we put in, and it's not easy at all. But I love what I do, and if I'll tell everybody else, go come do it, you know, it's nice, but definitely be genuine about it. Don't try to force it. That's my advice.
Yeah, and for me, I would say, like, everything you're not makes you everything you are. Like that Kanye West song, everything I'm not made me everything I am. So lean into that. Like, and also don't go crazy trying to talk to everybody. I remember at first I'm like, oh, well, my content has to appeal to all people. And now I'm like, I don't care. My content is for my people. Either you get me or you don't. Even if you're not Afro-Latina, even if you're not Dominican, even if you're not from the Bronx, like, you don't have to identify with that to be like, she's really cool. Like, I could be her friend, you know? Like, you can look past all of that and still see me as a person. You can feel my energy. You can feel my spirit. You can feel my passion, and you can still connect with me. And just because you're not Dominican, Black, from the Bronx, like that, you know, that doesn't mean that you still can't find beauty in my content and what I create. And so, you know, instead of focusing on trying to talk to everyone, find out what your niche audience is and talk to them. Like, I have a very niche audience, and I'm okay with that. I'm not here for everyone. Not everyone is going to like me. People are going to think that I'm loud, that I talk too much, that I talk too fast, that I use my hands, da, da, da. And I don't care, because I am who I am, and the people that are for me, and they're going to gravitate towards me. But at the end of the day, like, you are going to respect my hustle. You're going to respect my work. You're going to respect my creativity. Like, you may not have to like me, but you can say, wow, like, that girl works really hard, that, you know? And so just do it. There's someone out there is hoping that you like to see themselves reflected, and there's enough to go around for everyone, right? Alexa and I are both Afro-Latinas. We both create similar content, but it's like, she, me and her are very different, because she's her and I am me, and no one is you, and that is your superpower. She has her own life experiences that bring that beautiful passion to the work that she does. I have my own life experiences. So, like, forget what everyone else is doing. Forget how many people are doing it. Like, you can do this. You can do this. I was doing this for fun. I never in a million years, if you would have told me 12 years ago, like, girl, you're going to be doing this full time, you're going to be having multiple businesses, I would have been like, you're absolutely kidding. Yeah. And here I am. So just go for it, because life is too short to be living with regrets. Like, and it's going to take time, and time is going to pass by anyway. So, like, 5 years from now, do you want to be like, dang, if I would have started 5 years ago, I would have been, you know, like, the difference between you and somebody else is that they literally just went for it. They started. They may not be as talented as you, but because they believe themselves enough, they started. So, like, hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. Just start and see where it goes.
And I will also say, don't compare yourself to people on the internet, because that's the worst thing you could ever do in your life. Do not compare yourself. Focus on you, focus on your path, your journey. And I promise everything's going to come to you, and it's because what's for you is going to come for you. And that's something that I had to learn myself, because I used to compare myself a lot, even like with numbers, with likes, with followers. I was that person at some point. And I had to tell myself, you know what? I'm not going to do that. Like, I'm just going to keep being myself. And what's for me is going to come for me, because I'm genuine about it and I love what I do. So, you know, like, as long as you're doing your part, you're going to be fine. So.
Beautiful. Thank you so much. Y'all are getting so much love in the chat, and I love it. So people are asking, obviously, if y'all can share your Instagram handles, and you can pop them in the chat if you like, or before you go, do you want to kind of tell anybody about any projects you're working on, so people can keep a lookout for some of the things that y'all are, I'm sure you have a lot of things going on, as you were mentioning earlier. So do y'all want to briefly mention some of the things you're going to be working on next?
Go ahead, Ala, you can go.
Yeah, so we are busy working on our holiday collection for Vecina Couture. Vecina Couture is my luxury robe wear line and the latest business that I've been working with. This is one of the samples that we're working on. Everything is made in the US. It's a lot of work. Sometimes I'm like, what did I get myself into? But it's so rewarding and it's so fulfilling seeing women wear designs that I created myself. Vecina is the name that I call my community, because they're like my vecinas. They're my digital vecinas. And I picked the word couture because it's like high fashion, made to order, right? And I feel like you know, I'm that girl next door, like, or the girl in the building next door in the Bronx, but I'm very much like, I like nice things. So I feel like vecina couture, it's like your regular degular girl from next door, but also like likes nice things. And I feel like we deserve nice things in our community for so long. It's like, we don't deserve nice things. We can't afford nice things. And I'm so sick and tired of that narrative. We deserve to have whatever we want. We deserve the best of everything. And like, no one is doing it for us with that little sazon. I'm going to do it for us. So we're working on our holiday collection. So stay tuned for that.
For me, okay, what I'm working on. Okay, so I just launched my business 2 months ago, guys. It's very new. It's very, thank you guys. It's called Darling Skin. So basically all I have is 100% organic products that I make in my kitchen, okay? No chemicals. The two main products that I have right now is a body butter and a bath and body oil that I create at home. And the purpose of this, the reason why I created this brand is because I was sick and tired of wearing lotions, because they will dry my skin up and they will not stay on my skin. I will have to like, I'll put lotion on and then 2 hours later, I'll be ashy again. I hated that. That's the purpose of it. And also because my grandmother is a holistic lady and we've always tried everything that we do in the house is natural medicine. So I've always I love natural stuff, pretty much. I stay away from any chemicals. So that's pretty much with that, Darling Skin, with my brand, I'm pretty much just, you know, hustling, y'all. You know, that's it. Working on my stuff. I'm actually planning my event for next year. I do a vision board event every year, and this is going to be my third event. I hopefully can come.
Yeah, we got to chat, because I've been doing vision boards for 5 years. I've been doing vision boards for 10 years and events, vision board events for five. Goodbye and chill is what it's called. I'm very big on manifesting.
Yeah.
This is a whole other live where we start talking about spirituality. I'm so big on spirituality.
Yeah, so that's what I've been doing. So I'm working on that as well, just planning everything for next year. So yeah, that's pretty much what I do.
Wow, just blown away by both of you. You're amazing.
Thank you.
Spirit, souls, I feel your energy. I'm just about to go sacar mi bandera right now. Thank you both so much for a beautiful conversation, a very honest and raw conversation on what it's like to be Afro-Latina in our communities. I'm sure, I know most of the people appreciate it just off the love in the chat. I hope people are able to check you all out, and hopefully we're able to have you again for one of our future events. And with that being said, for all of our audience panelists, thank you for sending questions. Please fill out this post survey that's going on in the chat so we can have more events like these at Glendale Community College. And Alexa and Ada, muchas gracias. Thank you so much for being here and for giving us some of your time.
Thank you so much. This is amazing. I wish I would have gone to this school. Like, what? These events are so cool. So I hope you guys are all taking advantage of this. I love this so much. Thanks for having us.
Thank you for having me as well. It was great. I loved it.
Thank you both.
Bye. Llega la lluvia para limpiar las heridas, a veces solo una gota puede vencer la sequía y para qué.